Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning. We do have a new member joining our committee today, and I would like to warmly welcome Paul O'Kane, who replaces Pam Duncan-Glancy as our Labour member. I would also like to thank Pam for her valuable contribution to the committee and its work during this parliamentary session when it began. And I'm sure that all members will join me in wishing her all the best in her new role. Our first agenda item is to agree to take item 3, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Moving on to agenda item 2, and that is to hear from stakeholders supporting asylum seekers in Scotland. This morning we will hear from Pinar Aksu, Human Rights and Advocacy Coordinator, Maryhill Integration Network; Selina Hales, I beg your pardon, Founder and Director of Refugee; Nick Hobbs, Head of Advice and Investigations, Children's Young People's Commissioner Scotland; Maria Jose Pavez, Policy Officer, Grampian Region Equality Council; Savan Kadir, Project Manager, Refugees for Justice; and Dr. Sarah Stewart, Volunteer and Partnership Manager, Friends of Scottish Settlers. And you are all very welcome this morning. I would like to refer members to papers 1 and 2, and shortly after our panel members have given a short opening statement, we will then move to questions. And with opening remarks, I would like to start with Pinar.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Good morning. My name is Pinar Aksu, as mentioned, Human Rights and Advocacy Coordinator at Maryhill Integration Network. Hence the name. We are based in the north side of the city in Glasgow, and we've been working since 2001 to provide direct support and provision and activities to welcome people in our communities, especially people who are seeking asylum, refuge, migrants, and with the local community. So I'm delighted to be here, and also joined with me is Herbert, who's sitting behind, a volunteer with Min Voices Group. We'd be interested to discuss, especially with the usage of hotel accommodation across the country, how this is impacting on integration and welcoming people, and how this is changing the landscape of the provisions that we do. Also, with this comes the issues around accessing education, accessing free transport, also the impact on mental health as well, especially not knowing the time scale and how long people are going to be within the asylum process, but as well as with staying in the hotel accommodation as well. We're delighted to be here, so I'm looking forward to answering questions. Thanks.
Thank you. Selina?
Hello, everybody. I'm Selina Hales. I'm the founder and chief exec of the charity Refugee in Glasgow. We set up in late 2015 to welcome forcibly displaced people to Glasgow and Scotland, and what we've actually become is a critical support provider for refugee communities. We regularly see over 300 visitors in our city centre offices, people seeking dignity and basic support such as food, toiletries, clothing, language support and companionship. We're not currently funded by the government or local authorities to deliver any of the services that we offer. I say this not as a criticism of funding strategies, but to emphasise that communities can see what policymakers and the Home Office appear not to. We currently offer travel support, we offer English classes, we offer creative clubs, we offer bespoke food support designed around whether or not the family or individual has access to a kitchen. We offer art therapy for traumatised children. We do this because communities make that possible with their donations and their understanding of need. Communities recognise what governments are not. The poverty and trauma caused and exacerbated by our asylum and refugee systems are inhumane. They are undignified and, most importantly for today's discussion, they're unnecessary. The current systems are failing people spectacularly, and the illegal migration bill will increase this failure to a point that I and nobody else in this sector thought possible in this country. You have tangible actions that you can take to change that. I'm here today to share stories that me and my team hear daily about these failing systems. You can define that as evidence, but I will politely refuse to use that language because it further dehumanises the people that have lived experience and trauma as a result of our failures to act. We have to stop shying away from what is happening here. We are witnessing not only law-breaking, but systemic racism and white supremacy at its finest. I will not be complicit by refusing to call it what it is.
Thank you. Nick?
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Nick Hobbs. I'm Head of Advice and Investigations at the Office of the Children and Young People's Commissioner for Scotland. Our statutory function, as most of you will probably know, is to promote and safeguard the human rights of all children in Scotland up to the age of 18 and up to 21 if care experienced. We're looking forward to discussing some of our work, which recently has been focused around the Illegal Migration Bill. We've described it as a direct assault on the concept of human rights, and especially on the notion of universality, the idea that we all have human rights by virtue of being human. The harm that it's going to cause, both directly and indirectly, to children and young people in the context of a system which is already harmful is really hard, I think, to overstate. The first Children's Commissioner, Kathleen Marshall, used to say that there are reserved issues but no reserved children. The bill and decisions made in the system, in the wider immigration system, impacts on children's rights to education, to physical and mental health, to development, to safety and protection from harm, and these are all devolved areas. So that means we need to really urgently consider how the Scottish Government and Scottish public authorities can use the powers they have to reduce the harm that's going to be caused by this piece of legislation, because there are things that can be done. There are steps that can be taken to mitigate some of its cruelty, and I look forward to having the opportunity to discuss those with the committee today. Thank you.
Thank you. Ria?
Good morning, my name is Maria Jose Pavez. I am Grampian Regional Equality Council's Policy Officer. We are a charity based in Aberdeen, working to advance equality and tackle discrimination. Since the arrival of people seeking asylum to a hotel in Aberdeen in 2021, we have been working in coordination with No Recourse Northeast Partnership and Aberdeen's third and public sector. We have been collaborating to address people's needs and build up a more appropriate infrastructure to do this. But all of this in a very challenging context, as the arrival of people seeking asylum occurred before the full dispersal policy was even announced. So there was no time to prepare, very limited resources and capacity to respond to it. What we have seen with the widening of dispersal in Scotland is that the asylum system is completely inadequate at different levels. The lack of appropriate resources for localities and the concentration of it on private contractors is not conducive to a quick and meaningful local response. The long time to issue decisions on asylum claims and the use of hotels affect people's mental health and negatively impact the chances to integrate into the local community. Some of the specific issues which have particularly concerned us include access to immigration advice, because in the northeast of Scotland and basically outside of the central belt, we don't have solicitors that provide this service with legal aid. People have seen access to a solicitor delayed, and of course it's far from ideal to have all the preparation meetings on a cell phone and online, basically. Travelling could be an option, but currently, because people is only entitled to £9 a week, that's not really feasible. We have also seen lack of sufficient ESOL provision, with a particular gap for absolute beginners or people needing literacy support, so we're not being able to teach people how to read and write. There's also no provision in place to prevent destitution for people with refused asylum claims and appeals rights exhausted. These are only some of the issues affecting people on the ground, and unfortunately, even though we have the new Scots integration strategy and the preventing destitution strategy, the implementation is far from where it should be for people seeking asylum. Now, the Illegal Migration Bill, when passed, will make matters worse at all levels. It will mean the end of the asylum system. It will push people into even more vulnerable situations, including the shadow economy, exploitation, and trafficking. Again, access to immigration advice is a key concern, as people will have only a few days to build up a strong case to challenge removal from the UK. Now, imagine that situation for someone in a hotel in Aberdeen or a rural hotel in Aberdeenshire or the Highlands, with a broken phone and perhaps without a SIM card, which is something we've seen, and without organizations to offer support within walking distance. We believe that a more strategic and overarching response is needed in Scotland, one that considers the consequences of the Illegal Migration Bill and enables integration as much as possible, especially in areas where we can and should be doing more in terms of access to immigration advice, education, English and literacy provision, mental health support, support for victims of trafficking and travelling across the country. This all presents opportunities special opportunities for Scotland to do more and do what is right and show our commitment to uphold human rights and international law.
Thank you. Savan?
Good morning, everyone. My name is Savan Kadir. I'm a Refugee for Justice project manager. Refugee for Justice established after the parking incident in 26th of June 2020. Since then, we've been campaigning to say the use of hotel is dangerous and it's harmful to people who are living in, and it's also proven to be very expensive as well, and it's not a place that people should be living in, and it will undermine the whole principle of integration, especially the New Skills Integration Strategy. Today, I also like to talk about two things. One of them is the Illegal Migration Bill. We believe the Illegal Migration Bill is an act of vandalism of every principle of 1951 Refugee Convention, and also the value we as a community hold dear. And the bill is deeply misguided, and it ignores the root of the people seeking refuge in the first place, which are fleeing from persecution, or they might come for family reunion, language ties, or colonial relationships. And lastly, on the immigration bill for now, it's the bill only designed to serve one party's political agenda. There is no single evidence that this bill will be working any better than the recent nasty nationality and borders bill. It also shows the UK government's intention is not to deal with the real issues in the broken asylum system, instead abolishing it all. Just like a parent who their child asks them to teach them how to ride a bike, but the parent instead selling the bike, so they no longer have to deal with the challenges that come in with parenting. And the use of hotels, the private companies such as Mears are making huge profit paid by us, taxpayers, to run what we believe to be inadequate public service. Let's not forget that it's a massive task to look after the most vulnerable, often traumatized individuals. Simply, these services must be run by public bodies like local authorities, and we should be learning from the schemes like the Ukrainian scheme and the Syrian resettlement scheme, when local authority were directly funded by the UK government. And that's it for now. I'm looking forward to have more questions from the committee and discussing all of these things.
Thank you. Sarah?
Hi, I'm Sarah Stewart, and I am the Volunteer and Partnership Manager for Friends of Scottish Settlers, or FOSS. We are a small charity in Falkirk, trying to implement the New Scots strategy, basically integration from day one. But we have found ourselves, we are a befriending charity, but we starting, you know, with Syrian families who started coming in 2016. But since October 2021, most of our resources have gone to supporting men in an asylum hotel in Falkirk and addressing the massive gaps in their support. Did I mention we're tiny, and trying to get movement on certain aspects that, you know, ESOL, particularly for beginners, transport. Falkirk doesn't have the asylum support ecology of Glasgow, for instance, or, you know, bigger cities. So where the guys might have more access to ESOL in Glasgow options, we can only provide, you know, a small thing. We've got volunteers who do one day a week. We've been trying to work with the local college, but that provision is very patchy and only applies to some people. We can't get absolute beginners into anything. We want to do more befriending, but we find ourselves having to advocate for very, very basic support. And these things that, you know, we've been able to go a long way in Glasgow, for instance, we are starting from square one, and it's taken, you know, over a year to build local relationships to get people into, you know, into integrate into spaces where they can integrate, because this does happen and it happens very successfully, but it takes a lot of footwork that we really don't have the resources to, you know, to do the best that we could in this area. So
Thank you. Thanks very much. Once again, welcome everyone. And it was really interesting to hear the variety of issues that you have all mentioned. And I'm hoping that myself and my colleagues here today will be able to get further information and delve a little bit deeper into that. So I'm going to start us off. Obviously, I have a special interest in all of this topic, but children in particular is where I would like to start with. Last week we heard some evidence regarding the use of hotels, and some of my colleagues will widen that bit out, but I want to concentrate on the experience of children in particular, and an illustration of what it is like for a child of an asylum seeker. I think it would be good to hear on the record what that experience is like, the effect on the child, the family, their mental health, their access to services. We also heard that there is a hotel that that is being used especially for housing unaccompanied children. So if you have more information on that, I think that would be important to hear as well. So if I could start off with Pinar, please, and then bring in Nick, but I'm sure Selena will have something to say about that, and anyone else on the panel, if something isn't mentioned, please feel free to alert me to that. But Pinar, please.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think in our experience, we have people who has been in the asylum process for many years. We have the people who are arriving newly and who are being put into hotel accommodations throughout the country. But then we have people in the asylum system who's been waiting, in some cases, more than 5 years, more than 10 years. And as you can imagine, the huge impact of the unknown for building their life, for building their future, and the impact this is having on their mental health. And an example I could give is that during the pandemic, we were stuck in the houses for a few months and we could see how that impacted on us. But we're talking about people being in the system for years of not being able to do anything. And the children of these of the people who are seeking asylum, there's a huge barrier, especially when children reach the age of attending to college or to university. Once they reach that age, as we know, people can not attend full-time courses at colleges, and they can not go to university because they will be treated as international students. So we have people who are in the asylum process who cannot go to university. And then we have the children of the people who are in the asylum process, where they reach the age of 16, 17, 18. They apply to university, but they're refused because they're not citizen, and they are treated as international students. So they're expected to pay the fee of an international student. There are some universities who provide some scholarships. However, these scholarships, we're talking about between 5 to 10 scholarships per university, which is not enough. And there's a competition of applying to the scholarship, who's going to go to university. And this is a huge barrier, because it then stops people to further their life of accessing education, which we think that it's a violation to someone's right to have the right to go to university and access education. We were involved with a case with Just Right Scotland, with Andy, for one of our member who was a migrant, as well as of this case. We are also campaigning to ask the Scottish Government, as well as the UK Government, to extend the right for people to access university. Because this is having huge impact, and people are forced to study part-time courses at college level. And at the end of the day, throughout the years, they're studying courses which then they might not be able to use. And that's another issue as well in Scotland. People cannot go to colleges and study full-time courses, so they're only allowed to study part-time courses. And we find that quite troubling. And in cases for people who are in hotel accommodations, this is not even an option to apply to college. We've heard cases, and I'm sure others will also mention as well, where people are applying to colleges. However, they're saying that there's no capacity at the colleges. Or in instance, because the hotel accommodation is meant to be an initial accommodation and it's meant to be temporary, where it's meant to be used up to 6 months, some of the colleges are not accepting asylum seekers because they're saying there's no point of them starting the education where they might be moved. But then people are stuck in the hotels for more than 6 months, in some cases more than 1 year. So then they're left in this limbo of not having access to education, not having the right to be accessing education. And as I mentioned, the impact on mental health is incredible. We have members, and I see members I've met 5 years ago, and I look at them now and when I first met them, and you could see the difference on them, where they just gave up in life pretty much, because they don't know when they will hear from the Home Office. They're worried about the impact of the new illegal migration bill, which we call it as the refugee ban, because it will directly ban people to have any sort of right to seek asylum in our country. So people are also scared of how this is going to impact on them. And then they're going to be stuck in this system for many years of not knowing what's going to happen to them. So in our case, this is a huge concern for us. We have also people who are young people and children who want to access different services. For example, we had one case where a person who's seeking asylum, their child is playing for Cricket Scotland, and there's a game that they need to attend. However, there's a fee attached to the game, and they need to buy new kits, and they need to buy new materials and items, and it's just not possible to do that when you're an asylum seeker, when you're giving £45 per week on your asylum support. So people are then being dependent on charities. However, then charities are at its capacity where we cannot and anyone cannot provide to its fullest. So we have that child, you know, not participating equally and having the equal opportunity as every other child would have in this country. We had cases where we had a child coming to our service and asking the mum, why are you not working? Mum, why can we not go to the cinema? Mum, why can I not buy that item? You know, simple questions like this. And again, because people are not allowed to work, they're being dependent on the asylum support and on the charities. And I'm just thinking the impact this is going to have on a child's well-being and on their mental health as well, and how it's going to create a society where children are left behind and where they are experienced and forced to experience such poverty at a young age. And I would use the word discriminated at a young age as well.
Yeah. So I think it's very distressing to hear that, and just summarising it quickly. So there's no sort of like the access to the right to education isn't being fulfilled, in your opinion. There's no right to work, and the access to money is not there either, because of the limit on the £45, and the impact on mental health is long and very traumatic, which is very, very distressing to hear. Can I bring Nick in? Because I'm sure that there's other things that you can add to Pinar's quite powerful opening testimony.
Yeah, no, thank you, convener. I mean, what Pinar said reflects a lot of what we've seen through our own work. I mean, I think it's worth starting with a really clear statement that no child should be living in a hotel under any circumstances, regardless of your legal status, regardless of who has legal responsibility for your care, regardless of where you come from. A hotel is not an appropriate environment for a child to be living in. And I think that's really important. There are sort of two groups that I want to take the opportunity to reflect on, I think, here. One is unaccompanied asylum-seeking children, and we've been doing some work with a group called Young People's Voices through the Scottish Refugee Council about the experience of being accommodated in hotel accommodation, and really serious concerns, I think, about child protection safeguarding risks, which we've raised with the Scottish Government's child protection team, about the risk of exposure to alcohol and drugs, risk of violence, criminality, exploitation. And as Andy Cyril pointed out in the evidence session last week, it's not just the Home Office using hotels now, unfortunately. You know, we are seeing it being used by local authorities in Scotland, and that's really concerning. I think it speaks to broader issues about how our systems are functioning, about chronic shortages of resources, and really about the extent to which, you know, we in Scotland are keeping the promise in relation to these children. They're looked after. You know, they have legal status. Scottish ministers have corporate parenting responsibilities towards them. Local authorities have corporate parenting duties towards them. And we are not fulfilling those duties if we're accommodating them in hotels. The second group, I think, that we're particularly concerned about is mothers and babies, or mothers and very young children. So I know members will probably be familiar with the report that we laid in Parliament last year on the so-called mother and baby unit that was being run in Glasgow by Mears. That wasn't a hotel, but it shared many of the same issues of that appear in hotel accommodation, of living in institutional type accommodation. So mothers raised with us issues around around food, nutrition, around safety, around physical and mental health, around children's development, around the ability of children to access education, to engage in play and leisure. You know, all of these really significant and interconnected children's rights issues. We've also visited one of the hotels, and I won't name it because I know we're all needing to be really sensitive about doing that, but one of the hotels where mothers and babies are also being accommodated here. And again, exactly the same issues coming out. These are environments that that create and exacerbate trauma, that exacerbate health issues, particularly mental health issues. And we are really concerned, I think, about children aged 0 to 2, because what you're dealing with then is an environment that's not just impacting on an individual, it's impacting on an individual and their relationship with the child and directly and indirectly on that child as well. So we know the connection between maternal health and infant health. We know the importance of those first 2 years in terms of children's development, and these are environments that are having, you know, really profoundly negative impacts and consequences on all of those things. I think one of the most difficult conversations I think we had during those visits was talking to women who were with relatively newborn children, so children in the first few months of life. And it's really easy, I think, in that circumstance, in the best of environments and with all of the support that you could wish around you, to very often find yourself in a situation where you feel like you're failing as a parent because your child's not eating, they're not sleeping properly, you're worried about their developmental milestones. You know, it's really, really easy to find yourself in that situation. And what became really clear talking to some of the mothers in those environments in the hotel and in the unit was the extent to which they were feeling that, not through anything that they had done, but because of decisions made by the state. So we were talking to women who were saying, you know, because I'm not able to go down to lunch or to dinner at the times they're being served, because I've got a small child and my baby doesn't care when lunch is being served. They need what they need when they need, and I get time when it kind of happens. That they were really struggling to breastfeed, and were experiencing that as a failure, their failure of parenting. And of course, it's not their failure; it's the failure of the state to support them, the failure of the state to value them and their children as human beings, to value the relationship between mother and child, and to put in place what's needed to protect it. So those are the two groups that I'm kind of particularly concerned about. Really happy to talk more about that.
Thanks, Nick. Can I bring Selena in just now, please?
Yeah, to support in what both Pina and Nick have spoken on, what I see day to day and my team see are the people that are living in these hotels seeking safe spaces that they can exist in. Because a single hotel room whilst pregnant and with a 2-year-old child and being in that hotel room for 6 months is not a space that anyone should have to exist in. But that is what we see day in, day out. One of the most important things that we did not expect at Refugee to be providing was space. We are currently living under a system where space is actually an act of dignity. That is horrifying. We should all be ashamed on that. To add some other real life examples, we currently have one of our advisory board who spent 8 months in one of the worst hotels in Glasgow with her 2 young children. As if that isn't a poor enough experience and a failure in itself. Whilst in that hotel, her children were unwell because of the food lacking nutrition. Instead of that food being looked at, instead of any review taking place over whether there were 5 a day or any fresh food, because it's packed lunches every lunch for 6 months. Instead of a review of the food taking place, her children were given medication. We drugged the children rather than look at the problem. That's failure. That is absolute failure. Alongside that, what we have experienced at Refugee is a refusal by both housing officers and hotel staff to let charities engage with individuals housed in hotels. Now, that for me is the biggest problem here, because without organisations like Maryhill Integration Network, like Refugee, like FOSS, without those connections within communities, that is when mental health, isolation, depression, that is when everybody suffers. The same mum with her two children in the hotel. I had a knock at her door one day and there was a charity in the space who was offering support. She hadn't called them, she hadn't asked them to be there. The following day, the police came to her door because the hotel staff had reported that she had had unauthorised visitors in the hotel. Two police officers. She described her children hiding behind the bed, sobbing because they thought their mummy was going to get taken away by these police officers. I can hardly keep it together repeating that story, and I've said that out loud three times now. That is a huge failure. We need this to be remedied now. There are so many elements of it that we are in control of, like proper training of housing officers, like proper training of the hotel staff, because certainly if I'd applied for a job in hospitality and I ended up being a detention officer, I might have some concerns over that. It is an unsafe environment for every individual that is currently part of that, and we need it to change.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Can I just ask you, going back to the spaces that you were talking about, I have personal experience in my own constituency of no communal area where mothers could meet up with other mothers with children. Is that, I want to know, how common is that, that the children don't get any areas where they can get together and be with other kids, and the right to play, of course, is what I'm referring to, as well as family time. Is there any sort of like remedies that are made for that, Nick?
Just I can speak in terms of the experience that we've had going into a couple of these places. I'm sure my colleagues will have much more to add. Certainly the mother and baby unit, there was no common space. And the rooms themselves were tiny, so that was one of the big issues, was that the natural developmental process that you would expect a child 0 to 2 to follow, you know, where you're putting them on the floor, they're learning how to roll over, they're pulling themselves up on things, they're learning how to walk and to toddle. There was no space for any of that to happen, so there was a really negative impact on their development. And the same is true in certainly a number of the hotel rooms that we've seen. Even where there is common space, it's really limited in what you can use it for. It's in what I'm thinking of, it was one common space for the whole hotel, which included not just kind of women and children of a really wide variety of ages, but also kind of single adults. You know, people have very different needs for that space. Children particularly, you know, need a space that feels theirs, that feels safe, that has the room to run about, that's kind of set up in a way that you know allows them to do that safely, and that simply didn't exist in the spaces that we were looking at.
Thank you. Tina?
Yeah, I think for us, I see two elements to this. So when people are in normal accommodations, for example, one of the things that we do is we've got a women's group where women are invited to come to the space and have activity, and we also provide a creche where children have that space as well, which is great when people are in the communities. The issue we see is when we have women with children in hotel accommodations, if there are no spaces, then if they are meant to go to an integration network or a community space, that's also in itself is very difficult. Again, to take a bus or to walk to the space, it takes a lot of, first of all, expenses. As we know, in Glasgow, an all day is now £5.40. So you're talking about, if you were to get travel to somewhere, you're talking about £45 now going to £40, your weekly allowance. So that's an issue that we see for the parents and for women especially to come to the premises. And the other issue that we see is the minute we normalise the hotel accommodations by creating spaces between the hotel accommodations, then that's a big problem for us. Because why? It gives the reasoning for mayors to normalise hotels for long term. And this is not something we want. We do not want people to stay in hotel accommodations for years and years. We want people to be back into the community as it was before the pandemic, where people were giving houses in the communities, where then they were able to go to different networks, then they were able to go to colleges or to their education spaces. The minute we normalise and expand the usage of hotel accommodation, then there is a problem with that, because then it gives the reasoning of stay put in someone and is making sure that somebody stays in the hotel for a very long time. And this is something we strongly oppose, that we belong, we believe that people belong in communities and not in hotel accommodations.
Thank you.
Just very briefly.
Hang on a second, because I was going to bring Maggie in as well, and I'm conscious that I'm taking up a lot of time here. So if you don't mind, I'm going to move on, but you will get opportunity to raise your points that you want to bring. Maggie, please.
Thanks very much, Kirkhever, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. And I just want to say I share your fury and rage at what's happening, both with the illegal migration bill and the constant undermining of human beings. Selina, I take your point about the language we use very, very, very much to heart. And I think when we're functioning in a system that is so dehumanising and marginalising in everything that we say and do around this matters. I've often raised the question of the use of institutional accommodation, because that's what we're talking about when we're talking about hotels. Pina, you've just talked there about the normalisation of not having community, which is essentially what we're doing. And I want to explore a few issues in this, but particularly the issues around who gets access. And Selina, you spoke a little bit about charities not being let in, but I want to, if I may, and I know you want to come back in, and I'm sure you will. But Maria, if I could come to you and your work with GREC, I'm aware of some of the issues in at one particular hotel. Again, I won't name in Aberdeen, where local community people wanted to go in and help, and indeed were going in and supporting and helping and just befriending, being human beings with the asylum seekers, and they were banned from the hotels. And I just wondered how widespread in your view you feel that is, how what ability is there, given the control that MIAS has over access, over all of that, how can we actually unpick this to allow community in, even if we can't build the proper community that we want?
Yes. So I'm mindful there's been a few concerns around safeguarding from MIRS, and that's why there's been some issues. Mm-hmm. I don't know specifically what happened. That's, I know, fine. You raised this last week as well. Yeah. I can look into it and find out more information and get back to you on that. However, I do think that it is important, the access that we get to the mm-hmm. hotels, but at the same time, it is really important that we get access to raise awareness of the services and the organizations that are out there in the community, mm-hmm. so people can go to them as well. That gives people agency, the capacity to choose which organizations to go to. So I think it's really key that at the beginning, when we go to the hotels, we raise awareness on this and welcome people to go out into the communities, to our organizations, and raise the different services that we have, for example, like GREC, casework, language and integration, language cafe every week. It is really important that we do that and do not bring all the services to the hotel, because that's not conducive to integration as well.
Okay, thank you. So with some of the conversations that you've had, I take the point that you made earlier about this being easier in some parts of the country than in others. What are the challenges, particularly in Aberdeen, that you are finding around that ecology of support organisations? You spoke specifically of accessing legal support, but are there other challenges that we need to be addressing here?
Yes, so openly, the lack of resources leads to not having the capacity to address the situation. At the very beginning, for months, we struggled to even get the right clothing for people. For months, we struggled to get phones, SIM cards for people. Unfortunately, it has relied many times on the capacity of volunteers, but we cannot build up a system relying on volunteers solely. They need to be part of the system. So in that regard, it's a whole system approach. There's just lack of fundings. Uh-huh. This was raised last week as well. Uh-huh. There's lack of fundings for the third sector and for the public sector. So the response locally is just not all-encompassing. And yes, we struggle with the basics.
Okay. Savan, if I can come to you, and when we talk about the sort of importance of integration, and I appreciate and I agree, Pina, with your point, you can't really be doing integration if you essentially locking people up in hotels for months and months and months on end. What capacity has there been, in your experience, to have community forums or community discussions where local residents can actually engage with those who are in hotels in safe spaces that aren't forced, aren't controlled, but are an environment where people can come together? Is that something that you see happening? Does it happen well in some places? Does it happen at all in others?
I think it's important to mention just the point Pinar said. The point of normalization of the hotel is something that we need to be very cautious about. Because as soon as we start providing those services that MERS and it's the responsibility of MERS and home office, if we cover that, those gaps for them, then they will be in a comfort zone and they will start expanding the service.
Right.
So, and about your point about community engagement and other things, the previous point about engaging with MERS and trying to build those connections so we can help asylum seekers and refugees living in the hotel. I think I've made an attempt to get that access and trying to help people to integrate and find services. Unfortunately, the communication breaks down when at some point. So it looks like they have some criteria for organization to come forward and to provide those services. I'm interested in community organizing. I'm an activist. If I go engage and speak with asylum seekers, the first thing I would do, I will talk about how they can resist the system. Because what's going wrong in the system now? What's going wrong in the hotel? It's the system.
Mm-hmm.
I think the short term support is important, but we need to change the system. So that's perhaps why they don't like us to get engaged so much. But in terms of safe spaces, we are in Refugees for Justice. We bring those people. I want to mention that I've got Siraj with me. I forgot to mention that he's here. I apologize. He's one of the heroes in the parking. He was witnessing the parking incident, and this is what exactly wrong. After the parking incident, we should all learn the Home Office, MERS, local authority. We should have all learned that the use of hotel in all the terms are wrong, and we should stop it. Instead, they start expanding them.
Mm.
There was only a few hotels in Glasgow. They expanded them in all around Glasgow, and then across Scotland. And that shows the lack of caring for human suffering. And if you take the parking incident as an example, I may be a little bit further away from the question you asked, but if we take the incident as an example, what we should have learned and how we should have acted, you'll soon realize they don't care about integration, and there is no infrastructure to integrate asylum seekers in refugees in communities. There's no funds and resources for organisations to do that mm-hmm. job properly. And as like Maria said, there are locations that there's no organisation there. I had an engagement with an MSP. He said, my community never had asylum seekers in the community, in our constituency. Could you please come and you know, just describe it? What would it look like to be an asylum seeker and seeking asylum? Because I'm sure the community will freak out in that term. So that's mm-hmm. how much infrastructure in place to welcome refugees and help them to integrate.
Thanks, Ivan. I wonder if I can just explore that point a little bit further, because obviously MERS has the contract, the Home Office contract, to run these hotels. And I wonder whether you see examples elsewhere, and I'm thinking back, one scheme that I'm familiar with was the Syrian refugee resettlement program in 2015. It started where there was what seemed to be an attempt at genuine partnership working between local authorities, the NHS, and the third sector, so certainly in some parts of Scotland. Do you see one of the fundamental problems with the situation we've got at the moment is this is essentially contracting out to a private company that has no interest and no need to properly engage with local authorities, with the charity sector, with other support organisations? Is that one of the structural systemic issues that you were talking about?
I mean, absolutely. I mean, private companies, they go where money takes them, and then they're not interested in learning about human suffering or care about this. And this is a vital service. We're talking about the most vulnerable people coming here with traumatized experience often, and we cannot give that service to a private company who the only intention is making profit. And there's other ways we can do this, is funding a third sector organization that they can find housing. That has been done in Germany. Mm-hmm. I'm currently looking at a study called Leverkusen study, which is currently addressing that, how the government, and exactly the way you said, health board and other part, gain involved together and with third sector and providing houses and services, which is I found to be very, very adequate and working very well. But until we stop, we have to privatize services that is connected to human beings. Mm. I mean, you can privatize something, a service that's about a machine, but when it comes to human being, we have to be very, very careful, because the profit is the only goal for them.
Okay. To comment on this, in terms of community engagement, when I came here on 7th of February, I mentioned about the increase of racism and discrimination this is going to cause in our communities, and I briefly highlighted my concern in Erskine, and unfortunately that was an example where there was a lack of engagement with the communities by the local authority where the hotel accommodation is being built, and the locals were not being informed. And this is what's happening in terms of engagement with the locals. And I appreciate my point was taken seriously. However, still, when the hotels are being opening in the areas, there is lack of engagement with the local community members. And this is where one of the biggest problems comes along, where there is no infrastructure built. Because, for example, let's say there's going to be a hotel built right next to the Scottish Parliament. And if the Scottish Parliament is not involved or in this process of the hotel being opening or hotel being used, and no one is engaged to say that this is the people who are coming into the hotel, the Scottish Parliament will want to know what to do. Mm. And this is where the engagement with the locals come into place, and this is where the spaces that needs to be created. And I think this is something we can do in Scotland, where we can, when the local areas are informed about a hotel being used in the area, this is something within the power in Scotland we can try to have whether a training or information with the locals to inform that this is what's happening in the community. And I think this is something we can easily do. And in terms of the privatisation, the hotels are making millions for temporarily hosting people in their hotels. And if this profit was to be used in the local community, first of all, it will benefit the local community. It will benefit the people who are being housed. It will benefit in terms of that money going back into the different services. So the millions of profit being made into by the hotels is outrageous. And I think this one of the biggest problems that comes is after the parking incidents, Glasgow was the only dispersal city. And then Glasgow City Council made the decision of not being the dispersal city. And then that opened the gates for hotels to be used across the country. So my question would be, as part of this discussion and the inquiry, is whether Glasgow City Council will be in contact and we restart that conversation of being the dispersal city again. Okay, thank you. I've got other questions, but I'm conscious of time.
Can I just add there what's really, really important on everything that Pinar has said is we've seen it done differently. And it doesn't mean that hotel use is correct in any way. We still dispute its use entirely. But the Ukrainian system was different. The Ukrainian hotels are different. The education around the use of those hotels and the education within our schools about the war in Ukraine, about the children joining their classrooms, every single part of it has been different and they have been welcomed. So we've already seen it happen. So it's possible.
Thanks, Selena. I think that we're going to come back to the Ukrainian scheme and look at that in more detail later on. Can I just bring in Rachel, please?
Yeah, it's just a quick question on a couple of issues Savan and Pinar have raised regarding the local authorities. Why do you think that the local authorities haven't kind of taken on board the criticisms regarding the current hotel provision and are going down that route? And you also mentioned about third sector moving into this space, but we already know that 10,000 children in Scotland live in temporary accommodation. So how would you suggest that that is done differently?
So the suggestion of the local authority getting involved, it was was built on the previous experience we had with Syrian resettlement scheme and other schemes we had. And also by looking at other countries, for example, Berlin, Finland, other countries that they involve local authority in every move and in promoting integration, but also looking after asylum seekers and refugees. And I think that has done before in other countries very successfully. And I think that's the model we need to explore. And at the moment, colleagues might know much better than me in this, at the moment, there's a problem with funding. So wherever we have engagement with local authority and trying to ask them for something, they said the Home Office is not providing us any fund for this service. We already stretch, you know, we already stretch. So the service they already provide is already more than what they expected to do so. And I mean, we had an engagement with local authority. We were saying, let's explore a model when the Home Office providing you money directly and you can build infrastructure. That's including housing and other support provision. And one of the things that's happening now, Mia's group is not contributing a penny to schools, NHS and other services. They just sitting down and making profit, and they're expecting councils to fill those gaps for them. So I think one of the benefits is on that model, it might not be like a silver bullet to fix everything overnight, but that's the model we have to explore for the long-term solution. Otherwise, we're just going to be in a limbo with private companies, you know, making profits and not caring about human beings, and people will be suffering and will never integrate into society. By the end.
And have you come across examples of refugees returning to their home countries because of lack of services, whether it's education or transport, as mentioned, or housing or health services?
I mean, I haven't came across some people going back home for that, because people fleeing from war and persecution. Mm. So it's between a death and a life decision. So I don't think people will be running away from that. But I mean, the minimum standard is for any human being is to have access to healthcare and to education and other essential services, I would say.
So anyone else on the panel?
I can speak to helping one of our volunteers yesterday complete their application for voluntary return because the asylum system is taking so long and she has been separated from her other two children who are back home for so long. She can't start family reunification until her status has been awarded. She has no idea when that's going to happen. She's now been here 2 years and she's broken. She is completely and utterly broken by our system. So she's returning to a different part of her homeland to hopefully be able to find her children and be reunited, because she can't deal with the heartbreak and isolation. So yes, we are seeing people forced into situations where if their country is a safer place to return back to, they are. We certainly see it with Ukrainian system as well, people moving back and forth as well.
I raised that last week actually regarding the pause in the super sponsor scheme and Ukrainian families having to relocate in parts of Scotland where it is another upheaval for them and their children in the education establishment. Pina, I did pick up on some of the points that you made regarding doing it differently and using local authorities to perhaps take... Would you recommend that they take a different stance? But how? How can they when there's such a housing shortage?
Mm-hmm. I think we need to remind ourselves that people were in communities before the pandemic. And this is a strategy by mayors and Home Office of distracting from the hostile environment that they've created over the years by placing people into hotels. We need to remember that everything in terms of welcoming people, in terms of integration services, obviously there were some gaps. However, it worked when people were in normal accommodations. So we don't need to explore new options, actually. We know that it's worked for many years. It worked from the early starts of 2000s when people arrived from different countries, from Kosovo and Iraq and Afghanistan. So we did welcome people and the structure is there. It is working. The difference now is the strategy by the Home Office, where they are using hotels where they are profiting from this, where the hotels are profiting from this, where they are underfunding local authorities to create a hostile environment, to create division in our communities. And this is exactly what we are seeing. In terms of for the long term of this and how it could work differently, like I said, it has worked previously and we don't need to reinvent the wheel. We just need to acknowledge the fact that there is a shortage of housing. This is not anything to do with people who are seeking asylum and refuge. This is a problem for the country. So we need to differentiate this, the fact that, yes, we do have a housing crisis. However, this is not the fault of refugees. This is a fact, and maybe this needs to be addressed. And this has not to be blamed on people who are seeking asylum and refuge. Mm-hmm. In terms of people returning, this is what the Home Office wanted to achieve, to create an environment where people are not welcomed here and, unfortunately, where they see themselves to be returned rather than seeing to living in a limbo for many, many years where they cannot build their life. When we're talking about people, we're talking about around 5,000 people, around that number of people who are seeking asylum and refuge in Scotland. We're not talking about hundreds of thousands of people. We're not talking about millions of people. When people flee from persecution, they go to neighbouring countries, places like Turkey, Jordan, Pakistan, Lebanon. These are the countries that people go, and these are the countries that takes millions of people. If we cannot build a structure to welcome people who are around 5,000 people, then we need to seriously question ourselves over what kind of a country we're creating if we cannot even build an infrastructure to welcome this little amount of people who are in need of safety and in need of protection. Then we have a serious issue around human rights within this country and our obligation to international protection.
Do you want me to ask my last question on the English
as long as
language?
It's very small, because I want to
and then
move
I can
on.
Finish. It was around the a number of the panellists have mentioned the gaps around ESOL provision, and obviously each one of you are trying to integrate people into community by allowing people to give them the tools to communicate in the country. You know, what more can we do in Scotland to ensure that people have that provision? Do you want to come in?
So I just also wanted to mention the difference we have seen in terms of working with the council, with people who have representation with the council, have an officer or who have someone within whose remit this is, to working with the guys in the hotel who it's so easy for them to fall off the, you know, list of priorities. We're constantly having to remind people that they are there. So, you know, in terms of ESOL, you know, the council will do what they can in terms of, or, you know, they might be able to, we can fit a few in this class, but that, you know, we've got 50 people, you know, in one hotel, for instance. You know, we've been working with the college. You know, we talked to our MSP and, you know, there was some funding available. That stops in June. You know, so we've got, and that's only for 16 of the guys. There are ESOL resources. There are things that can be set up for people. But also, you know, it's just, you know, there's extra provision for, you know, there's one of the guys who got into an ESOL course, but he had a long waiting list, but he got in there. It's not like he's not allowed to, but, you know, he had to wait for months, but he's surrounded by Ukrainians, but none of the other guys have access to that. You know, there just isn't space for those guys on that course. And we're able to negotiate these wee things. You know, someone could fit into that there, or someone, you know, could fit into this other thing there. We've got a transport scheme where we can try and get people into ESOL classes in other cities. But that again has a limit on it. We're doing a huge amount of footwork to shoehorn people into these things where they don't have, you know, it's us and CESREC who are you know, trying to get them into things that are covering gaps that, you know, as we've said before, if we had a person, you know, whose responsibility this was, but it's always they're always being kicked over into some other, you know, oh, we'll talk to this person, or why don't you talk to that person on the council, or see if they can, you know, put them into that. And it's like, this is not a strategy. This is not, I can't emphasize enough how unfair this is on local people to, you know, to have to try and patch together an ESOL, mm-hmm. you know, and to, because we're the people who are going to the hotels, we're standing in front of someone and we're saying we're trying our best and we just can't.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you very much. Maria.
Doesn't help also that Scotland doesn't have an ESOL strategy anymore. Now it's integrated into the
adult. Can you repeat that?
Yes, Scotland doesn't have an ESOL strategy anymore. Yeah. Now it's integrated into the adult learning strategy. So many times the councils or the college, just like, it doesn't fall into anyone's remit. For example, provision for people with an RPF into anyone's remit. And people for beginners and for literacy provision, there's nothing for people with an RPF. And we're not talking big numbers either, but there's nothing in place, no funding, and because it's not clearly stated and there's not any guidance on ESOL, no one takes responsibility for it.
Nick.
I'll be really quick because I'm conscious of time, but this is one area I think where Scottish Government could do something, because the issues that have been raised with us are about young people who don't need ESOL provision but are being forced to do it because that's the only educational opportunity that's available to them. So government's got a consultation, has just finished a consultation on access to education regulations. One of the things they could be doing with that is opening up further and higher education to these young people who don't actually need the ESOL provision, which would then in turn free up ESOL provision for those that do need it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for that. Can I move on to Karen, please?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you so much for your contributions so far. I suppose that kind of aligns straight into what I was going to be asking, and that's focusing on some of the solutions. Asylum and immigration policy is a reserved matter, but there are things that we can do within our devolved competence here at the Scottish Parliament. There are things, although we are fiscally constrained, you know, in many ways, there are things we can do. Can I ask, what are your feelings about the new Scots strategy? What's going well? What isn't going so well? And the ending destitution strategy?
To start, if that's okay. In terms of using the new Scots strategy and ending destitution, we find that it's a great tool for us, and I'm sure it's a great tool for many other organisations across Scotland who are starting to provide help for people. However, it's not a legally binding document. We find that it is a strategy that we follow it. And as you mentioned, there are areas that within the strategy that Scotland has power to do and change, such as housing is a devolved matter, education is a devolved matter, transport is a devolved matter. One of the biggest campaigns, together with some of the people on this panel as well, is the free bus travel campaign we are doing at the moment. And as part of the campaign, what we are asking is for people who are in the asylum process to have free bus travel across Scotland. And as heard earlier as well, it would make life a little easier for people when they're already living in such horrific conditions. When we have people who are living in Aberdeen or Falkirk in Edinburgh trying to access their legal right, trying to access the right to have a representation, it will give them that opportunity to travel. And when they are travelling to different services, whether to college or to just simply go to a more populated area and to meet friends, it will provide them the opportunity for this. We are aware that there is a pilot being done at the moment. However, we also find that the evidence is there. There's been evidence by FOSS, by Sarah, by Maria, that this need is immediate. And we have raised this issue at nearly 2 years ago now, that it is within the power of Scottish Government. There has been discussions around this at the CPG on migration as well. So Maryhill Integration Network is the secretariat for the CPG on migration. And there was discussions with how this could be possibly done and the impact it may have on people and people's asylum support. However, there's been some great legal advice taken and explored by Just Right Scotland, as well as different groups as well. So we feel that this is a campaign that would literally in some cases save lives, where people are put into a hotel accommodation where they are in their rooms, which is described by some of our members as their cells, where they would be able to move out of the hotel and meet their friends and at least create a normal environment for them. In terms of the other areas which we might be able to highlight is the access to education, as Nick already mentioned as well. As part of the consultation by the Scottish Government, we also participated in that and highlighted that it's an area where extending the right to education for people who are seeking asylum would again save lives, where people will be able to have the right to education. We have some members who were lucky enough to receive one of the scholarship at the University of Glasgow, and now they're studying their master's. But again, an issue comes is when the education finishes, what will happen to them in terms of not being able to work? If they want to further their education, there would be again a barrier within that. However, we would be really interested to see the outcomes of the consultation by the Scottish Government, whether it would be acknowledged to include people seeking asylum as well, to extend the right to education in that area too. Okay.
Bring in Savan just now. Mm-hmm. Savan.
Yeah, so I just want to say, just existing the strategy itself is one of the great things, because I've looked at the New Scotland integration strategy. It's one of the most detailed integration strategy I can see around the world. But however, there's so much nice things about it, and it says a lot of nice things. It's like it says how it should be, but not how we should do it. The steps taken to get there, and I think it would be very, very useful to have a guidance around, because we as an organisation, when we operate, there are. Stuff that we don't know what kind of responsibility Scottish Government had clearly. So I think one of the things that Scottish Government can do is to provide a guidance for local authority and us as well as the third sector to tell us what the provisions that the Scottish Government can cover in terms of refugees and asylum seekers, right? One of the things Pinar said about bus passes, I think that's essential, and it shouldn't be any question about it. Like, people are living. I know some people, like, they called me, they said, I have been going out every day in the morning, like, for almost six months. I do same road, go back. I have no purpose of living. I don't know why to wake up, because I'm in a limbo for 6 months, and I don't know how many more months I'm going to be there. He said, I don't feel like I have a purposeful life, and I can totally understand that. I've been in the system myself for 6 years. And I know how it feels. So I think the bus pass is one of the things that provided take the burden away of paying a lot of money to travel somewhere just to meet somebody. And it's a very easy one the Scottish Government can do. I don't think it even needs to think about it. And one of the things others the New Scotland Integration Strategy does is human rights in its heart in every approach that New Scotland Integration Strategy is taking. But also there's the barriers overlapping the reserve matter and devolve matter. So it says what it should be, but it doesn't outline how we should get there. And I think perhaps we might think about a strategy that is doable, like it's an absolutely doable, and then that will be easier to legislate as well, like Finland. Finland has an act of integration promotion, which all devolve departments involve in promoting integration. So I think if it is a doable strategy, just outline what Scottish Government can do exactly and legislate it, so every part of the government's body are responsible in promoting integration.
I've just seen lots of hands go up there.
I missed that.
Maria, I think, was it?
Just wanted to briefly share that we implemented a bus scheme, a free bus pass scheme in Aberdeen for six months last year. We approached First Bus and explained the situation of people seeking asylum in Aberdeen, and they, with us, implemented a scheme for 6 months that gave access to 100 people to local bus passes, though. Mm-hmm. That lasted June to December, and in November, December, we gathered feedback of service users through a focus group and also a survey, and we have that available. We would share that with the committee so you can consider it, but it's definitely something that the Scottish Government can work on. and it's something that would partially address the issue around immigration advice, because then people would be able to travel to access immigration advice to the central belt.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just, yeah, again, I'll be as quick as I can. Just building on the point that Savan made, I think I'm not always seeing the connection between the principles that are set out in the strategy and practice, and I'll give you a couple of very quick examples. So when public authorities are consulted by the Home Office and MEERS on accommodation provision, it seems to us from what we've seen that what they're doing is responding on the basis of impact on service delivery, not through a human rights lens, so not thinking about what's the impact on the human rights of the children who are going to be placed in this accommodation, what do we know about the area, what can we bring to that decision-making process. And they don't, and it's fair to say, they don't have the power to prevent it, but they do have the power to make an argument around it, and that's not happening consistently enough. The second point, I think, is around the recourse to public funds and that implementation gap that we see between, I think, now a very clear understanding at a kind of senior level within local authorities that there are duties here on Scottish public bodies, particularly around Article 3 of the European Convention, to protect children from the impacts of destitution. But we're still seeing, and again, colleagues will talk about this in much more detail, we're still seeing people turned away at the front line from support. So the most important thing I think we could probably do around the New Scots strategy is bolster it by incorporating the UNCRC and other human rights treaties directly into domestic law, which gives you a legal framework within which the principles of the strategy can be applied.
Thank you. And Sarah.
Want to underscore how, I mean, the New Scots strategy has been hugely important to our organisation. It's been a wonderful guide, but to echo what the other speakers have said, it's profoundly different to try to implement that when you're not in Glasgow or, you know, a place like Edinburgh. If people are able to move, they do a lot of integration work on their own, but if they don't have that sort of agency, then it falls on, you know, on others. They are made even more vulnerable. And we've just recently got some funding to do a train scheme so people can go to Edinburgh or Glasgow twice a week. And within the first week, you know, people have been, you know, visiting other communities. The Eritreans get to go to the Eritrean church, you know, in Glasgow, because we can't cater to that in Falkirk. And I can't emphasise enough how big of a difference that makes in terms of what we're able to do, you know, with local community as well, and, you know, just being able to do that activities and for them to be able to choose, you know, because otherwise I really hate the idea that we're all they've got, and that's not fair on them or on us.
Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to go on and ask about travel and the positive impacts that would have on people, but I think you've clearly stated your point on that matter, and that's something absolutely noted. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Karen. Pam, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel, and thank you so much for your opening statements. Much of the discussion last week was around illegal trafficking and exploitation, which today it was mentioned as well. So my question is around two parts. What role does Police Scotland alongside the third sector play? But also, since Police Scotland began 10 years ago, there's been 140 police stations but also a lot of community policing cut as well. So what kind of impact has that had on reducing community tensions, as well as rooting out illegal trafficking and slavery? And I'll ask my question to Pinar first. Yeah,
thank you for that question. And in terms of our engagement with the local police officers, so we do tend to engage in a way that the local police officers would come along and discuss about the services they provide, and especially to build that connection so that if instance or cases of hate crime or racism that takes place, people feel comfortable to know where their police local police station is and to go and report to that. In terms of the service cuts, I mean, that's very unfortunate. However, that's the current government's budget cuts that's been implemented across the country to our different services. And one of the things that we see, as you mentioned, about doors being opening to trafficking and into all sorts of inhumane practices is with the new illegal migration bill. What I'm referring to is we are going to see community detentions being created in our cities and in our communities. The hotel accommodations will be turned into, and this is my thoughts on this, will be turned into community detentions where people will not be able to return to their country of origin. However, they will not be also be given status. So all these hotels that's being built at the moment will potentially be turning into community detentions. And that would leave people to be exploited. That would leave people where there might be trafficked or they might be exploited in horrendous conditions. And this is our biggest worry. And this is not... This is something that will happen in Scotland. It will is something that will happen in Glasgow, in Edinburgh, in Aberdeen, Dundee, across the various cities where there are hotel accommodations. So in relation to that, this is one of the biggest impact we're going to see with people being trafficked or people being exploited, where if the illegal, as we call it, the illegal migration bill passes, this will create... potential community detentions, this will have a huge impact on the people who are already in a very difficult position and system. Yeah.
Okay, sorry, Pinar, can I come back to the question?
Yeah.
So are you saying right now that all the community police and police are adequate for the services you need at the moment?
I'm not sure if I'm in the best position to comment on that, however, I might pass it to
yeah, is there anybody else?
I agree with what she said, but also I think the question, there's something there in the question. You've spoken about community tension. So I think what the community tension, how did that start? It started from the top with the language that the Home Secretary started and started from invaders and then go on with other things. So I think if we didn't have that type of language, we probably didn't need more officers to deal with the tension that comes with it. And I think about the UK Home Office is literally creating this environment that is community against each other. I think it's a part of a bigger problem we have. If we are talking about compassionate system, and if we use moderate language, so I'll probably say the police are enough. We don't need more police. I think we need more moderate, compassionate language, I would say.
Okay, Selena.
I think the question that you're asking would be best put towards the Tara Project, who work with victims of trafficking and modern-day slavery. So if there's an opportunity to invite them to feed in, then that should be done. So organisations here are potentially not best placed. I can speak specifically on how that engagement can work from a case that we dealt with last year at Refugee. A woman presented to us who we suspected was a victim of trafficking. We were told that in order for her to access housing support for that night with her six-year-old child, she had to present to a police station. That's not an appropriate response. It was the only response that we got from social work services. So regardless of whether the police services are enough, regardless of, it's about how those organisations work together and communicate together. What I feel I was in the middle of was a funding bun fight between who was going to pay for this woman's accommodation for that night. Even when I presented that mother and child had spent their first night in Glasgow on the street, I was still told by social work that she had to present at the police station. When I told them that it wasn't appropriate for the woman to present at the police station for a number of reasons, I was told that's the only response. It's not about the number of officers, it's about the communication between those services being centering the human, centering the child at that, because I wouldn't want to present to a police station in Glasgow on a Friday night with my six-year-old child. I cannot imagine how that felt for a woman with very limited English who'd just escaped from an incredibly difficult situation.
Thank you. Nick?
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's, to answer a slightly different part of your question, it's I think genuinely one of the most extraordinary parts of the illegal migration bill is the extent to which it gold plates the business model for human trafficking. You know, if you don't protect victims, you're not going to convict traffickers. Makes the job of the police much, much harder. The age assessment provisions mean there's a real risk, I think, of misidentifying child victims as adults and thereby removing them even further from the protections within the human trafficking system. And it also creates not just a risk that we don't prosecute the criminals, but that instead we prosecute the victims, the people who've been exploited, that they're subject to arrest, detention, charge, prosecution, in violation of Scotland's obligations in terms of the non-punishment principle. And that's something we're going to be discussing with the Lord Advocate when we meet her next week. One of our real concerns about how does the Scottish criminal justice system respond to this bill, because it's going to need to respond to this bill, because it's going to make our ability to meet our international obligations much, much harder.
Thank you. Could I ask my second question, or do you want me to come back to it?
If we have time, you can come back to it. Is that okay? I'm just going to try and move out. I want to bring Paul in, if that's all right. Paul.
Thank you very much, convener. I'm very grateful, and good morning to the panel. A number of the areas that I was particularly interested in, I think we've touched on already, particularly in terms of provision of ESOL and other services. So I think I will, if it's okay with you, convener, speak about the Ukrainian scheme, because we've already heard reference to that this morning. And I think there is a degree to which there is learning to be taken from that, I think both in terms of a positive, but obviously at the moment we're also seeing some of the challenges that exist in that space. So I wonder if I can just be quite broad and say, what do you feel the positive learning has been from that? And I know, Selena, you started to touch on, I suppose, the welcome, the kind of integration model, you know, those sorts of things. So I don't know if you want to maybe start.
Yeah, I think the positives are that is what we have witnessed is what happens when there is education right in the early stages. So, and that's not simply down to communities, that's down to our media. So we were all aware immediately when war broke out in Ukraine. We had information, we had knowledge, there were Ukrainian flags up in windows of houses, children were being taught about it in schools, and it is the clearest example of what happens when we have open conversations about a situation prior to arrival. That's possibly where my positivity stops, because what we then witnessed was the clearest example of racism that I have ever seen in this country. That response was something that we were told wasn't possible. We have all in this sector been told for years that that volume of arrivals isn't possible, that rapidity in the right to work, the all of the elements of that project, of that programme, the scheme, we were told weren't possible. And I will not let it go unsaid that that is anything but evidence of systemic racism at the core of some of our decision making, and that's horrifying and needs to be dealt with. So I would love to see a similar scheme rolled out. I would love for that. There are elements of it that I would consider safe passage. I would love to see that widened to include other areas. But as a person who had to sit in my office and explain to multiple people why they weren't entitled to the same things, all it came down to was the country that you were from. And funnily enough, every single country was black or brown people, and that's not good enough.
Just to come into that, if that's okay, just strongly agreeing what's been said, and I think that's the model that is going to be presented also with the illegal migration bill, is the two-tier refugee system we're talking about, and also the deserving and the undeserving refugees, those who are deserving the protection and those who are not deserving the protection. And I think that's what we have witnessed in terms of with the Syrian resettlement programme and also with the Ukrainian resettlement programme. The rights are completely different. When somebody is in the asylum process, they are given the asylum support. They don't have the right to work. They have not access to public funds. They are, in the recent cases, put into hotel accommodations. As with the Ukrainian refugees, as mentioned, they are given completely different rights, where they have the right to work, where they have the right to public funds. And this does raise serious questions whether someone's country of origin plays a position in this with the rights that they're given. And as I mentioned, we had members who were confused about how they have been in the system for many years and how they not heard from the Home Office about their application, and we are talking about countries where there are ongoing wars, such as in Iraq, in Yemen, in Iran, and they've been in the system for many years, and they were questioning about why they haven't heard anything, but then why there was a scheme enrolled for people to give in the immediate rights. And of course, at the end of the day, it's people are running away from persecution and war, and it's not their fault that there is a system where the system itself divides and creates a two-tier system of the deserving, the undeserving, and the legal and the illegal system, where it puts people into position. And I think we do need to strongly highlight this, that there were positives into it, where people did open their doors, where people did welcome the Ukrainian refugees, which has been amazing, I think, in the communities. But then we have people in the system for many years. We are seeing what's happening in Sudan at the moment. We have many people in our communities who are who have been waiting in the asylum process for many years now, where they have families in Sudan and they're not able to bring here, and they're still in the asylum process. How much more of an evidence does the Home Office need to see that there is a war going on, whether that person deserves to have the right to seek asylum? And I don't think we should be shy away to say that this is systematic racism within the country.
Can I just say one sentence about it? Which is, let's not forget, this is, they are not privileged. This is how the system should be, and this is the model we should explore. So it's not a privileged refugees against. It's exactly how the scheme should be. And I don't understand why there isn't any Sudanese scheme. I mean, well, there's ongoing war, and I agree with everyone else. I just wanted to mention that they are not the privileged refugees, and this is exactly how should the system be.
Can I importantly add there that although this system, when compared to the asylum system, is far, far improved, it is still far from perfect. You heard earlier about the issues with ESOL access. What is the point of giving somebody right to work if they can't learn the language? We have thousands of Ukrainian individuals in Glasgow looking for ESOL support at the moment, desperate to contribute to their communities, just like anyone else I have ever met in the asylum system or with status. But the system looks good on paper, but you've got 2 years leave to remain. In that time, you've got to learn the language, you've got to find a job. You can't get on a housing system because you're only here 2 years, so no one's going to give you a mortgage, so you're trapped in a rental scheme. But how are you going to prove that you can rent a home if you don't have a job and a deposit? There's so many elements of it that actually look good, but aren't really good in principle either. So without the proper spend on ESOL, on travel, on all of the services that the third sector are picking up at the moment, without funding those, you're not going to get people contributing to communities because they won't have the language to do so. So there are real elements of it that need worked on and developed as well, but there are some definite positives. The fact that a single language is spoken as well means that communication across Ukrainian communities has meant that they have access to services quicker than any other group that I have seen arrive. So if we, for example, provided somebody with a mobile phone who was staying on the cruise ship in the Clyde, they then go back to that cruise ship, join the WhatsApp group, and all of a sudden you've got 1,200 people who all speak one single language. You've got 1,200 people who all know you can come to Refugee to get a phone. Now, we can't respond to that volume of need. So services on the ground have had to adjust to provide that support. We've had to hierarchy support in a way that we have never wanted to do. But you have to recognise some people are on universal credit. Some people are on £8 a week in a hotel budget. Some people have arrived with belongings, some people without. There are so many differentiating factors. It makes it very, very complex.
Whenever I can, because I think that's helpful in terms of looking at some of those issues, which I think are common. So actually, we've seen a pause to the super sponsor scheme around housing supply or longer-term accommodation supply. And obviously, there is a conversation at the moment about the use of modular accommodation, which I think is of concern. So I think really just to get a sense of we've heard already, I think, that that's the broader challenge. Now, that's not the fault of, refugees and people coming to this country. But, you know, would you be concerned by the idea of that sort of exploration of modular accommodation? And, you know, what further do you think needs to be done in the Ukrainian scheme and more broadly to try and deal with some of these issues?
Can you please clarify what you mean by modular accommodation?
So obviously there has been a discussion to use, you know, Ukraine longer term kind of resettlement funding, if you like, to look at modular housing, so prefab housing.
Right.
But there is a suggestion that that could become, you know, in a sense, camps, to use that expression, which I think we would all find quite uncomfortable. You know, and is your concern that actually without the proper resource and kind of long-term look, we're going to end up in that scenario?
Absolutely. Yeah. Whilst it's easy to look at it simply, so on reflection, for me, the fact that we spent £39 million on a cruise ship on the Clyde for 6 months is utterly horrifying. Like, that figure, the idea of that being invested into housing systems in Scotland is transformatory. And that, whether that's prefab, whether it feels camp environment or not, compared to a cabin on the lower decks of a cruise ship, then it's far, far superior. But that's an easy thing to look at in hindsight. You know, it's easy to reflect on that. We had a huge number of people arrive very, very quickly. We needed to respond very quickly. But it wasn't ever as temporary as it should have been. So, yes, that investment is needed. No, we should not be comparing the accommodation as it stands, so cruise ship cabins and hotels, as the sort of, this is what we're looking to improve on. We need to aim higher, for sure. But I am not averse to prefab, quick build housing, because it's a dignity that so many people that I work with do not have and do not get. So yes, I think that's it's an improvement.
Just to comment on that, if that's okay. These are the sort of solutions we see at refugee camps, and where there's a mass migration of millions of people arriving, where they build refugee camps, which is meant to be temporary. If this is the solution that we have in this country, then again, we need to seriously reflect about our obligation within the international protection. There is a huge number of profit going around here. We've been mentioning about mayors outletting using hotels. We've been mentioning about temporary accommodations. We need to talk about who's making what profit in here and what amount of this profit is being directly invested back into the community. And some of the people who are arriving here, you know, we are going to have migration throughout history, and it might be migration in 2023, but the issue around migration is not going to end in 5 years or 10 years. So we need to once again go back to long term of practices of welcoming people into our communities and trying to create spaces for long term. And as mentioned before the pandemic, we had accommodations to house people. It is the language that's been imposed us, isn't it? As mentioned earlier, that we have the language around we have invasion in this country, the language around we have millions coming. We don't have millions coming into this country. We have maybe thousands coming along, and we always had migration coming along. And it's just about how we treat people and how we create that long-term sustainable welcoming spaces.
To be really clear, geographically, for that sort of housing, to only house one specific group of people, I could not be more against. If we're talking about increasing housing, it's housing for all. It's not an asylum-specific camp, because it does become a camp.
And I suppose that's been the concern that's been discussed, because I think, going back to what you previously said, I think universally, it is about how do you create a situation where people are accessing services, that services are well equipped in communities. Obviously, I represent West Scotland, so I had experience of the situation in Erskine. And it's about how do we bring people along with us and create that community. And it's not just at the margins or the edge of a community, it's actually fully integrated. So, and I think that's helpful, convener.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Fulton just now. Sorry, actually, Sarah, you were in my mind and you were highlighted. Fulton, can you give me a second, please? Sarah.
I just wanted to make one more point following on what Selena had said first about how people are perceived, and it's very... there's no person I've ever talked to, you know, at the asylum hotel who begrudges Ukrainians the support they've received because they know what it's like. And but there are areas of education. So we've talked to people who think that they are receiving the same thing and they simply are not taking advantage of it. And so having that distinction where a member of the public goes, well, surely they're getting X, Y, and Z thing because I've got a Ukrainian in my house and they're getting X, Y, and Z thing. And so that level of education and as Sivan had said, having a guide for local authorities and as I'd said before, a person within the local authority whose remit this is, so that you don't get Ukrainians siloed, you know, just with Ukrainians because we also have... you know, cases where people at the hotel have received their status and there are hubs that Ukrainians can go to, but they are excluded from those hubs, you know, and we'll try and, you know, because there's not an understanding that they actually, once they do receive their status, they have the same rights as people who have come from Ukraine and, you know, signing up for things and that sort of stuff. But this is just a lack of education. You know, it's not malicious, you know, the public's welcome of Ukrainians. They're not getting the same signals for other, mm-hmm. you know, nationalities. They're not, and so they think, well, something must be amiss. You know, something. You know, they've probably be offered something, but you know, they're just not taking it up because they're different. But that's just 100% not the case. And that is an education thing, and it's, you know, it's working with local authorities who are struggling to respond to something that they've not had to respond to before. And I just think there's lots of really good learnings with the, you know, the Ukraine scheme, but just the recognition that these are much smaller numbers and they're no less, you know, even some of them have the same legal entitlements, but they're not able to, you know, they're less able to get those because they're not recognised in a public consciousness as well as deserving of those things.
Thank you. Thanks. Fulton?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Again, a very, just like last week, if anybody had watched that, a very powerful session today. So I want to thank all of you for coming here and advocating for the most vulnerable in our society and doing it in such an impassioned way. And when we get to this stage, a lot of things have already been discussed, and I know we've already touched on the illegal migration bill, and I know that most of you will be aware there was a debate in the chamber last week on that, that many of us took part in, and an absolutely abhorrent piece of legislation. And I think that's, you know, well recognised by the speakers today. But what I wanted to ask about was, in relation to that, it's been put to us as a committee that a broader humanitarian strategy incorporating existing strategies that are already in place might be better placed to address, mitigate any consequences of the illegal migration bill. I'm wondering if MD would like to comment on that. And Convener, given the number of people on the panel, I'm quite happy to pass it back to you, Chair, who wants to come in.
Thank you. Maria, would you like to take that one?
Yes, just taking from what we were just considering, any consideration for housing needs to be long-term, sustainable, low-cost housing, because the illegal migration bill is not going to deter people from coming. We need to be prepared for the long-term, and a humanitarian strategy is needed. It's the subdivision in different schemes that prevents the New Scots integration strategy to be implemented as it should be. So if that's not working, then we need to think of an overarching, all-encompassing strategy with a humanitarian response for people seeking asylum.
Thank you. Nick? And then Sivan.
Yeah, I agree with Maria. I suppose my one slight, not reservation around it, but I think there's a need for maybe a twin-track approach, so a kind of consideration of strategies and how we what vehicle we use to get to where we need to go. But I think some of this is more urgent than that. You know, strategies take time to do. Mm-hmm. Even if government kind of rushes it through, you need to consult, you need to put the work in. and some of the stuff that we need to address is more urgent. So I would suggest that what I'd be worried about is that we put all of our eggs in the strategy basket and we don't deal with the immediate stuff that we need to look at.
Thank you. Savan.
Again, with everything, I just want to make two quick points. I think one of the things, two things that we need to be focusing on immediately will be, like, it will be a large number of undocumented migrants after passing the illegal migration bill, because people will simply not claim asylum if they know they will be deported. So we need to find a way how to support them not in destitution and also failed asylum seekers. After the 28 days, they will be detained. Most likely, they won't be deported to anywhere. Rwanda, deal is a fantasy land. It's not going to happen. So after that, people will be come back to the community, but in a state that they won't be eligible to get any support and they won't be eligible to their claim to be processed. So I think we should be focusing on what type of support in Scotland we can provide to those people who will be in those type of situation, especially preventing destitution and putting people in a position that will be easy for people to exploit them, and that's happening right now. So I think these are the two or three things, thinking about the way that people are not exploited and providing support, that people are not destitute, and finding a way to support undocumented migrants, because that's going to be a large number of people in the coming months and years.
Thank you. Pinar.
Yeah, just to echo what's been said, I think having a humanitarian response, again, in line with international protection and international law is very vital, and especially focusing around the Human Rights Act and the human rights obligations we have as a country. In terms of what we can do in Scotland and how we can oppose this, is there needs to be a much more strong message sent by the Scottish Government in opposing the illegal migration bill, and also focusing on the consequences it's going to have on us as a society. The more division that it's going to create in the communities, the more discrimination that people will be experiencing. And when we're discussing about the illegal migration bill, it reminds me of the TV series called Years and Years, where there was community detentions created, where there was refugee camps created in the communities. And for me, it reminds the fact that that's what we are living through now, where we are forced to have a response strategy as the legislations and laws are passed in Westminster. However, we need to oppose this with a strong message as possible in Scotland, to say that this is something that should not exist in our society, and it's something that in Scotland we are against, and use the power we have within the Scottish Parliament and government to also at least make the lives of people seeking asylum at ease by changing and working on the campaigns I've mentioned earlier.
Mm. Thank you. Maria.
The integration of the UNCRC has been mentioned as an added layer of protection, and I also wanted to raise that the Scottish Government has committed to send a new human rights bill to Parliament. So that's also something that could be an extra added layer of protection for human rights in Scotland.
Thank you. Fulton?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Convener. And Pinar and Maria actually went on to predict my next and final question, which was to ask what the panel think the Scottish Government and local authorities could do more within their powers. Is there more that the Scottish Government could do? I know that two of the panels here started to talk about that. And is there more that local authorities could do to mitigate this bill and generally with the situation?
Got a few hands coming up. A few of those suggestions have been made, but this is an opportunity for any additional ones to be brought to us. So I'll take Selena first, followed by Pinar, please.
For me, that centres around education, that if everybody around this room is in agreement that the illegal migration bill is abhorrent and horrendous, then it is our responsibility to make sure that other people know the detail of that. And that in the Scottish Parliament and in a local authority perspective is about that education going right the way through our communities. So in the same way that I emphasise that the reason the response to Ukraine was so different and what we witnessed was because everybody had awareness of it. There was understanding and education of what was going on in Ukraine from very, very early on. We need to do the same with this bill. We need schools to be talking about it. We need youth groups to be talking about it. We need ultimately for people to get as angry as we all are so that action is taken. Anger creates action, and we in this sector can turn that anger into real positive work across communities. So it's about all of us taking responsibility to educate those who maybe aren't aware what this bill will actually mean for individuals.
Thank you. Pinar?
Thank you. And thank you for that question. I think there's two strategies that we're talking about. Firstly, the aspect of, yes, we should strongly oppose the illegal migration bill, as called the refugee ban bill, and we should talk about the consequences that's going to have on us as a society and violation to human rights. The second, in terms of how we welcome people, there has to be resources for temporary mechanisms for people who are especially in hotel accommodations, but also for other organisations who has been doing the work for many years. So there has to be further investing within the organisations where they are able to create those safe spaces, where they are able to create the ongoing work that's been going on for many years. One of the things that we have also developed is a migration education resources, which is accessible for every teacher and educators in Scotland, and we are trying to push through this and work with the EIS, with the Education Institute of Scotland, with the union, to make sure that everyone is using the resources as a way of talking about why people move, why there are violations to human rights. So in terms of answering your questions, yes, we need to strongly oppose the bill, and we need to continue creating the welcoming spaces by acknowledging that there is a huge pressure on third sector and by using the power we have in Scotland. One thing I'd like to touch on, especially about the bus pass campaign, is the fact that third sector organisations, if they have the funding, do provide some form of voucher or some form of travel expense to people. So if we were to provide free travel to people in Scotland, that will also cut the burden on organisations where we always budget the travel expense and additional expenses that comes along with people travelling. So we need to also consider that as well and consider the benefit it would have on third sector, but also for the people if we were to extend the free bus pass. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Are we at Savan?
Yes, I just want to quickly say legal access to legal services is very important, especially for those areas the outside of Glasgow, because I think finding immigration advisors is quite a challenge outside of Glasgow. So I think if there would be any resources, there should be more proper resources and legal aid and having legal services, ring-fencing those people are seeking sanctuary here in outside of Glasgow.
Thank you. Pam, did you want to come back in? We've got an opportunity here. Hang on, sorry, I should have checked, actually. Fulton, are you happy? Yep, he is. However, Nick does want to come in. Excuse me, Pam. Yeah, I'll let Nick go first, and then you can come in with your supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I mean, I've had an opportunity to raise a number of the items on my shopping list already, so I'll restrict myself to the ones I haven't spoken about, except for incorporation of the UNCRC, because it's the really the one that sets the context for absolutely everything else. I think the Scottish Government needs to really consider the clash that's being created here between obligations under domestic law created by Westminster and its international treaty obligations. Mm. Like there's probably a pressing need for the government to take legal advice on that point. I think I would like to see a commitment from Scottish local authorities not to use the Home Office age assessment process or rely upon it unless they're expressly required to do so by law. I think we should be looking at the extent to which we're able to limit or restrict or delay or disrupt placement of detention facilities in Scotland, maybe by using planning legislation. And we think we need to look at the funding for those really critical third sector organisations, and the guardianship service is one that's kind of particularly kind of prominent in my mind, but also all of the organisations represented by colleagues around the table.
Thank you.
I'm actually unclear, Convener. Can I just press you, Nick, on the UNCR stuff in embedding those children's rights within to Scots law? You mentioned earlier around the new Scots strategy as well and incorporating the UNCRC within that. Are you asking for the government to publish a timetable?
Yes.
Right, thank you.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Fair enough. Pam?
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick one around. You've obviously mentioned a lot of things that the Scottish Government can do. I wanted to talk about access to health. Back in January, the Parliament was made aware that a case of a 22-year-old refugee who flew back to the war zone Kiev to see a doctor rather than wait for treatment in Scotland on the NHS. So it's just asking a question around that. Would you agree that more needs to be done from the Scottish Government on the level to access services, especially health? I know you've spoken about education earlier on, and you did touch on mental health as well. So it's just around that. What can the Scottish Government do more?
Yeah, I'm happy to come into it. In terms of accessing healthcare and the services, we had some cases where when people are in the asylum process, especially if they experience the need to visit a hospital, again, accessing the hospital in terms of travel there has been a huge barrier. There is a compensation, I think, when you access the hospitals that you can claim some of the fee back from NHS. However, there's been some barriers in terms of people having access to that and not being sure how that process is worked. Again, the issue around the cuts to NHS, I think that that's a wider issue that needs to be discussed. Maybe more evidence could be given by when you're talking with the other authorities as well. However, that just comes down to the ongoing privatisation we have of the NHS in this country, isn't it? Which is very unfortunate, which is being imposed on us by the current government. So that's an ongoing issue, I think, that needs to be highlighted by other organisations, and that's a problem that we have. However, when people are accessing healthcare, some people don't know that they have the right to register to GP. That's something that we already seen as well. When people are in hotel accommodations, they don't know that they have the right to be to register for a GP, or they have the right to be seen by a doctor. And I think that's an area that we could do in Scotland in terms of providing what rights people have in Scotland, whether you're an asylum seeker or a refugee. So I think that's an area that could be developed.
Selena.
I think, to echo exactly what Pinar said, we saw that happen again within the hotels that were specifically for Ukrainians. Healthcare provision was brought into those spaces so that, and it's not specifically for provision of healthcare, it's just the education around what you have the right to access. So we've seen that done differently and it works well. I think what we can't shy away from is that what we still have in Scotland and across the UK is an issue with racism and systemic racism within our healthcare system. We know that one in four black women I've forgotten the statistic. I'm really sorry. We know that black women are four times more likely to die in childbirth than white women. That's something that we all need to act on and to do something about. Obviously, that therefore affects our asylum and refugee communities far greater. I have witnessed that, I'm going to politely call it clumsiness, but the handling of people with English as a second language within our healthcare system leaves a lot to be desired. I've witnessed paramedics try to lift up a Muslim woman's top to put the cardio pads on without any conversation happening beforehand. Those are things that we need to tackle. And again, for me, it comes back to education again.
Just on that, Selena, so you've just mentioned racism. Obviously, we need to see the causes of this. Mm. And one of the areas you have mentioned is the language barrier. So actually earlier on, just speaking about the language barrier to integrate and go about, it's not even that. It's a fact to access healthcare as well. And absolutely, I think, you know, it's so important because obviously people come from different backgrounds and different religions, and we must be very careful not to break them. Exactly. And that's something, you know, I fully agree with you that, you know, taking somebody's top basically and stuff like that, they have to be very careful. So I think they definitely that we should be looking at language, especially spreading it. But I did mention earlier on in one of the committee meetings that not just do we should we be creating ESOL, delivering it through the usual sources, but maybe through community sources. It could be through mosques, it could be through gurdwaras, it could be through, you know, synagogues, different places that actually people also go to study there as well. So is that something you're in favour of?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
I think Savan wanted to come in very quickly.
Very quickly. I totally agree with you around the mental health. I think there's a big issue here. I think it's a broader issue. The whole UK is need to think about, which is the asylum seekers and refugees have a different needs, but they still have to go through the same route that everybody else goes. So I think it's not recognising that asylum seekers are already coming from traumatised background and fleeing war and persecution. They are in most immediate need. And what happened in the Parkinson was it was because of lack of support for the person who were involved in that incident. So I think what Scottish Government can do, definitely recognise that there is a special need for asylum seekers and refugees, and there need to be a special route for them, especially for mental health, to access mental health. But also, I agree with Pinar, I mean, the funding cuts and privatisation also broken down our NHS and put it on knees. But
Thank you. Thank you. We are coming to the towards the end of our evidence session, and we've heard lots of important and very powerful testimony. I just have one question to ask at the end, and then I will ask anybody who wishes to make a closing statement. You will have time to do that. So it's a big question, but I wonder if you could just answer it in, I mean, feel free if it's one word or a sentence. We've heard a lot about people slipping through a system, and we've heard about the areas that are devolved to Scotland. But of course, the main thing is that immigration is not devolved, it is a reserved matter. So I'd be interested to hear, and a yes or no would be absolutely fine. Do you think that immigration policy would be better if it was devolved to Scotland? Pinar, could I start with you?
Yes, I would say absolutely. And if we had that opportunity, we would create a more welcoming and we would create a system that is based on a humanitarian protection, which is based on human rights and international obligations. So we would be absolutely in favour of that.
Thank you. Selina?
Yes, I am confident, even though it's not a very high bar, but I'm confident that Scotland could do it better.
Nick?
I think there are a number of areas where we need to be looking at a Scottish-specific model, including identification of trafficking. Probably not going to express a view on the constitutional aspect of that, if that's okay, but what we need is a system that is human rights compliant, and that's absolutely what we don't have at the moment.
Thank you. Maria?
Based on the reality that we have at the moment, Scotland needs to do whatever is in our reach to make sure and uphold human rights are for everyone in Scotland.
Thank you. Savan?
Yeah, I think absolutely. I think it's a good way to test what the Scottish Government is saying and to see whether they do it. So I think only way to do that is, you know, get that power and have our immigration policy. And absolutely, it's a dream for me.
Sarah?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for your responses. I would like now to hand over back to the panel, and if people would like to make a closing statement and mention anything that they haven't covered so far, this is now your opportunity to do that. And if it's all right, I'd like to start with Pinar, please.
Yep, thank you so much. I'd also like to mention about, I think it would be really important as part of the inquiry that the committee is doing, is to directly engage with people with lived experience as well. So I'd be happy to take that on board later on for further discussion. I also have a statement to read, which is created by our members at MinVoices Group. And it's a group that is formed by people who are in the asylum process. And it starts as, dear members of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, thank you for creating this space for such an important topic. As members of the Min Voices Group, we have drafted the following statement explaining what we are experiencing. We hope you listen to our voices. Delay of decision, right to work, right to education, right to children's benefit, right to a lawyer. Staying in limbo, not being a citizen until papers are received, not being able to participate in real integration activities. Our mental health and well-being, we are isolated. We are missing our families. Not improving the level of living, not improving the skills and qualifications we have. All the time of stress and pressure, anxiety and depression. Higher demand for support from and for the charities. Limited access to ESOL classes, community centres. Time for waiting, months and years. Public resources, not enough, not having access to it. Delays in second interview. Asylum support is simply not enough to survive. Not being able to register for healthcare, restricted access to college, no access to university funding. The impact this is having for us, you may ask, frustrating, dehumanising, time wasting. When is my leave to remain given? More financial support is needed in transition from the asylum system to when receiving your status. Then when we are refused, the worry of being deported. MPs who are trying to contact Home Office for our delays, but the Home Office are giving the same answers for everyone. 3 months for a reply. 3 months for a reply. How can we live and survive in the same society with the unprecedented soaring cost of living when we are limited with rights? This is not being treated equally. Cut out the boundaries and let us live as you in the same country and in the same place with a human-centred system. Thank you. So I'd like to end my contribution with this. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Selina?
I have nothing to add that Min voices have not just put more eloquently than we can. I echo Pinar's request that the voices of those with lived experience of this system be heard, and we can certainly support that as well with an advisory board at Refugee that's entirely refugee-led. So please use that if helpful.
Thank you. Nick?
Totally agree about the importance of the Parliament being able to hear the voices of those who are actually experiencing the system, including children and young people. And I recognise that that's not always easy. It's not always straightforward. It might require parliamentarians to adapt systems that they might be quite comfortable with to something that maybe feels very uncomfortable, in order to make sure that children and young people are able to have their voices heard. But it is really, really important. So I hope the committee will give that some consideration. The only other thing I wanted to say, I think, that we've not really talked about is that all of this, the way the system works, is based on this idea of deterrence, the idea that you can deter people from seeking refuge and asylum. Home Office's own research says that you can't. It doesn't work. But that's what's underpinned the operation of the system for a decade or so, maybe more. And every time it doesn't work, because it's never going to work, and every time the government doubles down and spends more and more money on reinforcing failure, and it's like trying to fix a broken window by lobbing bigger and bigger rocks at it. And we're in a position in Scotland now where we're having to give really, really urgent consideration to how we can try to mitigate that, to what extent we can try and deal with the damage that's been caused by that broken window. And that's where I hope we've been able to provide you with some really constructive and some really positive examples of what could be done in Scotland to try and make things a little bit better.
Thank you. Thanks, Nick. Maria?
Yes, completely agree. Of course, we need to hear people with lived experience and the experiences of people seeking asylum. So I second that. And Nick, you mentioned something that I think it's also important to reiterate. There are specific areas where devolved powers allow the Scottish Government and Parliament to be more proactive and creative in areas related to education, transport, healthcare, and the others that we've covered during the session. That can be done in the shorter term. And then in parallel, we need to get to work on a more strategic and overarching level and considering the humanitarian response that we very much need in Scotland for the long term. And the last point is I will submit additional evidence, written evidence, so the committee can consider that as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Maria. Savan?
Yeah, I just wonder if I agree with everything they said, and I just want to mention one thing that I forgot to say, which is about those people who get the status in that they get 28 days to move the hotel and go to a different place. But now what's happening, I've got Siraj with me, I got permission so I can use his name. Siraj has been in a parking incident, obviously we know, I've mentioned that a few times. Now he got a status, but now he's going to be moved back again to the hotel. Again, thinking about re-traumatising someone who experienced that, and if as brave as Siraj is, I think it will be very difficult to go back to the same thing. So Mir's group is putting Siraj back and many others back to the hotel, almost like as if starting the very beginning. And about other things, I do also want to say, and I'm deeply, deeply disappointed about the illegal migration bill, not just because of the substance what's there, but mainly disappointed because the right of migrant and will be taken away by the hand of those who benefited from the system and their family benefited from the system. That's very disappointing. And it's like your parents are firefighters, but you become an arsonist. Thank you.
Thank you. Sarah?
Thank you very much to Pinar for bringing that here and to those of the Voices Network who made that. There are just a couple of things I want to just reinforce, and one was the travel aspect for us. We can't do New Scots without it. We're extremely limited without it, and I think more attention needs to be given to how that strategy works in places like Falkirk, where we have, you know, a case for someone, for instance, who got a sanctuary scholarship but was not able to take it up because he didn't live in Glasgow, and how travel is able to mitigate MIAs moving people from hotel to hotel. And so, you know, those people can continue, you know, on classes, for instance, if they're moved somewhere a bit farther away. But at the moment, you know, there's always that uncertainty. And that's one thing that, you know, that free travel would absolutely address. And also it would help us work together, you know, with other organisations in Glasgow. It would help us improve what we can offer people locally, not just to people in the asylum system, but to, you know, to all of our communities, because these people are a part of those communities. So, just more attention on how, and guidance on how this works for places like ours. You know, we talked about the NHS. People struggle to get healthcare providers to use interpreters. You know, that it's something that they might not be accustomed to doing. And so it's reminding people, you know, in budgets and things like that, oh, you might need to have that translated, you know, that it's not happened before, and that's not their fault. You know, it's just these new things that are coming up that they're unaccustomed to handle because they've not had, you know, for instance, Glasgow's experience of 20 years of, you know, of building up these provisions and having that being a normal thing. I've spoken about having this be someone's responsibility in terms of making sure people are okay on a local authority level, but I think also on a, you know, a Scottish Government level, so that these cases don't, you know, fall on us to deal with. There's loads of goodwill in local communities, and we've seen that with Ukraine. But there's, in order to unleash that, I suppose, we want to get back to doing mostly befriending. There's huge things that we can do when we're not, you know, when we're not stretched so much trying to provide very basic things. It's hard to do befriending things when people don't have shoes. And, you know, and that ESOL provision isn't there. We would like to supplement that, not to be the primary providers of that, and knowing that if these people move to another hotel, they won't get that. So I think having those things standardised, you know, we've talked about language, it's all there in the New Scots strategy, but I think also taking into account how the different difficulties that other, that, you know, communities that aren't in big cities have.
Thank you. Thank you very much. As we come to the conclusion of the formal business of this morning, I would like to thank all our panel contributors this morning. And I would also like to thank the two visitors that we have from our very rich and vibrant and resilient asylum seeker and refugee communities. And I think that we have heard some of your voices through our panels this morning. We have heard, I have heard your suggestions about engaging directly with those with lived experience, and I can confirm that as the convener it is absolutely my intention that we will do so, and the clerks will come and see you directly after this meeting in order to assist us that we can do that in the best possible way and hear directly from our communities of asylum seekers and refugees and their families as well. So once again, thank you very much for your contributions, and I now bring this part of the meeting to a close.